Okay, so my name is Peter Edwards. Did my PhD with Geoffrey Wilkinson at IC from 1976 to 1979, graduated with the PhD in 79. I was also an undergraduate at IC, so I met Jeff as a lecturer to my undergraduate course as well, which is entertaining. Subsequently, I went to the United States, California specifically, post-docking. I post-docked there for 3 years, 1 year with the late Bob Bow, who was particularly known for crystallography, but he wanted to introduce synthetic chemistry at the time into his research lab. Spent a year with Bob and then 2 years with Dick Anderson in Berkeley, which was an amazing time. And again, I first met Dick at IC when he was a temporary lecturer postdoc working with Jeff in the mid to late 1970s. Came back from the United States to the UK. I then postdoced with Jeff for about 18 months whilst looking for a job, an academic job, which I landed in 1984. I think it was the 1st of February 1984. I started in Cardiff as a junior lecturer and stayed there for my academic career, retiring a few years back as one of the senior chairs, the established chair in inorganic chemistry, and enjoyed it enormously. And of course, as a part of the benefit of being a graduate student with Jeff, carried me through through my academic career. Yeah, so that's me, potted biography. And have kept in very close contact with a number of old pals from IC in those days, and also until his untimely demise with Jeff as well. Yes, absolutely, and you know, in the occasional trips as a young academic up to London, visiting various institutions and giving lectures and so on, I'll drop in on Jeff. We'd typically go down to the Ennismore Arms for a pub lunch, couple of pints of beer, which is when the first time I knew Jeff to actually buy a round of drinks. And we used to have a very healthy and entertaining chat. I knew much of his research group at the time as well, some people whom carried on after I left there. And also one of my own early postdocs went to work with Jeff, a guy called Andrew Stanopoulos, and he spent a good number of years as Jeff's lieutenant until indeed Jeff died. I mean, it's the old phrase, how long have you got? Jeff was, he really was a unique character. Physically, he was quite a short man, probably about 5'6" in height, and he had piercing blue eyes. And he had, uncannily, especially as a short man, he had an extremely commanding presence. So whenever he walked into a busy room, immediately everybody would know that Geoffrey Wilkinson had walked in. He was, as a result of that, and especially with his fame and success, when I started my PhD, he had already won his Nobel Prize. So people were perhaps intimidated by him at the outset, and I didn't really know how to behave or how to respond when I started my PhD. But he immediately became very, very approachable. One of my abiding memories is how thorough and careful he was with most of his research group. He was one of those people who didn't suffer fawns at all. So the rare occasion of a research student who was more interested in playing cricket or going down to the pub than doing research, he would more or less ignore. But those people who were working hard and producing results, he was always interacting. He was extremely, I found him very easy to approach. He was always an absolute mine of advice, constantly coming out with suggestions and new ideas, which were very often completely off the wall, very left field suggestions. And as time rolled on, as your PhD started producing results, he would start leaving notes on your desk. So he was constantly thinking about the individual research projects going on and the individuals running those projects. Probably all his waking hours. And then in the morning you'd come in and see, you know, Peter, why don't you try the following, etc. Almost always there were totally wacky ideas that never panned out to be of any value. But on rare occasions, wonderful new things happened. He was absolutely fascinated by watching new chemistry materialize, seeing new chemical compounds being made. I remember after I came back from the States, I started exploiting a new route to oxo-rhenium halides that I developed as a graduate student. Oxo-rhenium halides, such as oxo-rhenium tetrachloride, trioxo-rhenium chloride or perennial chloride, were in the literature very difficult to synthesize. And I always thought that there would be great synthons, great starting materials for further chemistry. And Geoff had also put me at the early stages of my PhD on a project to make rhenium alkoxides and dialkyl amides, classes of compounds of interest at the time, which spectacularly failed. I ended up getting my PhD on rhenium alkyl chemistry. So the chemistry of more particularly rhenium clusters with metal carbon bonds and their structures and their properties and so on. But after I came back from the States, I thought this would be a good idea to exploit. I sat down with Geoff in designing this new route to oxo-rhenium alkyls, and which was by burning rhenium chlorides in oxygen, in pure dry oxygen. And I thought, well, we're losing chlorines off the rhenium center and replacing those with oxo functions. So the chlorines are going off at high temperature in an oxygen atmosphere, and chlorine oxides themselves are extremely nasty things, most notably detonate at relatively low temperatures. And I sat down with Geoff and explored this idea, and I said, look, I think, because we're doing this at such a high temperature, they're probably going to be spontaneously dissociate as they're formed and hopefully not be a problem. And Geoff said, sounds good to me. So I went ahead, had an explosion. I remember starting with 21 grams of rhenium trichloride. Had an explosion which destroyed the fume cupboard. The volatile oxochlorides I was freezing out in a cold bath, which was acetone with dry ice in it, that fractured, flew all over me, caught fire. So I did a human torch. Ran out of the lab, and a colleague, Rick Wong, who's in Hong Kong Baptist University, recently retired, I believe, wonderful chap, he actually put me out and took me over to the health center. But before I went over to the health center, I noticed, let's backtrack a little bit. In those days, we would dry our own solvents, for example, hydrocarbons and ethers, over sodium. And I had prepared a load of these solvents, petroleum ethers, toluene, and ethers, diethyl ether, THF, and so on. Winchester bottles, 2.5 liter bottles, all over sodium wire, and they were all stacked underneath this fume cupboard that had turned into an inferno. So I thought, yeah, this is clearly a very serious situation that could perhaps even lose the building. So one of the other graduate students started unrolling the fire hose, and I was shouting, "Use it!" as Geoff turned up, wondering what all the commotion was. And there was one of our one of the graduate students, a chap called Chris Howard, was holding this flaccid fire hose, not realizing that the fire hose is about 50 meters long and it takes time for the water to get to the nozzle. As Jeff turned up, and Jeff said, "Oh, for Christ's sake, Chris, give me that." And as the water hit, it lifted him off his feet as he was aiming this hugely powerful jet of water into the corner of the lab. So far as I'm aware, I think I'm one of only about five people in the world who's seen a Nobel laureate on the end of a fire hose using it in anger. But he was one of these really hands-on people. So, you know, that sort of exemplifies his excitement with the science as well as his involvement with his research group. And that particular research program produced a lot of results. And another example of his excitement with the nature of chemicals, one compound that I made was Oxo-rhenium tetra-T-butoxide from the chloride. And this stuff could be crystallized from petroleum ether as gorgeous amethyst-colored crystals, huge prismatic crystals. Very, very pretty stuff. But as soon as it warmed up to about ice temperature, about 0 Celsius, it just spontaneously decomposed in an amazing manner. No flashes of flame or whatever, it just suddenly went poof and generated a colourless liquid with a load of black precipitate. So getting an analytical data and so on to prove its composition was a bit of a challenge. And Jeff, you know, he said, "Well, where's the data on this new compound?" I said, "Yeah, I'm working on it, Jeff, you know." And he said, "Oh, you're taking your time." And so I went away and I sealed up a sample of this oxo-rhenium tetra-T-butoxide in a little ampule, kept it nice and cold, took it into his office, and there are these gorgeous, deep amethyst colored crystals, spectacular, iridescent, purpley blue. Nice crystals, about 3 or 4 millimeters on a side, in this little ampule under vacuum. And I said, "Okay, Jeff, here's some of that T-butoxide I was telling you about." And I gave him the ampule, and he said, "Oh, this looks really pretty. Why can't you get data on it?" And I said, "Well, just hold it in your hand for a few minutes." And just a couple of moments later, it went poof into a black residue and this colourless liquid. And he said, "Oh, very interesting," onwards and upwards. Fascinating. He was one of those very, very supportive people who was really inspirational. He really stimulated your imagination. He was unbounded by dogma. He loved arguing about people's preconceived notions in chemical sciences. You know, debates about mechanism and so on. He was extremely untrusting of the more theoretical approaches to explain our observations in chemistry. And that was really it was always challenging, quite inspirational. And I've recently been in touch with my old mentor, Dick Anderson, who unfortunately can't be at this meeting today. And he made a wonderful comment, so attributed to Dick. Dick described Geoffrey Wilkinson as the straw that stirred his drink, which I think is a lovely way to describe him. He truly was a magnificent man and generated huge respect, and also a number of enemies. Not being able to suffer fools gladly, he could rub a lot of people up the wrong way. A clear view of the fundamental concepts that underpin the chemistry he was doing. Another anecdote that exemplifies that is a lecture he gave after making hexamethyl tungsten, a compound he was very famous for. In the early 1970s, at the time that the organic chemistry community were very skeptical of the validity of these concepts of metal-carbon bonds, they didn't really understand how they could be stable. So he gave this lecture, I believe at MIT, about the WME6 chemistry. And at the end of the lecture, George Whiteside's a very famous then organic chemist, had a spectacular career in organometallic chemistry as well, and is still active. George asked Geoff, well, why do you think these things are stable? And Geoff said, George, do you believe in electronegativity? And that's a concept in chemistry that George had to answer yes to. He had nowhere to go. And that sort of clarity of perception ran all the way through his work. And a lot of that was instilled into his students.